160. We're going to be covering pages 88 to 89. And we're also going to combine this with another lesson, lesson 62, which is on page 90 and 91. And also this will be covering activity manual, page 73, with the activity that's connected with this. So in this case, the simple machines that we're going to talk about are the last three, and there's not a lot of detail with these last three, but is the inclined plane, the screw, and the wedge. All right, so let's get right to it, and we'll talk more about these simple machines. It says, have you ever watched workers load a moving van? The movers do not just lift items into the truck. Instead, they use a ramp when moving boxes and household items into their truck. Movers know that a ramp makes work easier. A ramp is a simple machine called an inclined plane. An inclined plane is a flat, sloped surface. It is mainly used to move an object against gravity to a higher position. Using an inclined plane reduces the amount of effort needed. The longer the inclined plane, the less force is needed to move the object. Okay, so we have a picture here of two people in your book. If you're wondering, it is these two pictures here. And the top one, you'll notice a difference between the bottom one. The top one, the ramp that he's using is much longer than the one on the bottom. Because remember, with each simple machine that we use, the greater the distance, less effort is required, or less force we need to use to move the load. So here, the inclined plane is longer. Okay? But if you look at the bottom one, and we learned this from yesterday, or in the previous lesson, that the shorter the distance, the more effort we need. And look, he is going a short distance, but he's having to push so much harder on that box to get it into the truck. All right, so remember, greater the distance, less effort. Now, the word inclined plane, incline, just means to raise up on one end. Okay, so my arm is flat, and then I lift it up on one end, that is an incline. Plane just means a flat surface. So the top of your desk is a plane, not an airplane. Okay, that's a different thing. But a plane in this case means a flat surface. So your kitchen table is a plane. The counter that maybe mom and dad chop up vegetables on, that is a plane. Anything that is a flat surface is a plane. And a plane can be this direction, it can be this direction. But inclined just means that it's raised up. Inclined plane. And the activity we're going to do later is going to be connected to this simple machine. The next one is called the screw. A screw is related to an inclined plane, or it's connected to the idea of an inclined plane. A screw is an inclined plane wound around an axle or wrapped around an axle. The inclined plane on the screw is called the thread. So you can see a picture of a screw in here, and those little lines that are going down the screw, those are called the threads. Mountain roads often wind around like a thread on a screw. Using the winding road to go up a mountain is easier than going straight up. The road has greater distance, so traveling on it requires less effort. So think about this, and I'm going to show you the idea of the threads wrapped around a screw in just a moment. But think about going up a very tall mountain. If you drive in a car straight up that mountain, yes, it's a short distance, but it's going to use a lot of effort to move that car up that distance. So mountain roads are not usually just straight up the mountain. What happens is the roads are usually like this, where the incline is very short, okay? And therefore, it doesn't take much effort to go up the mountain. Okay, so go zigzag like this up to the very top. And that requires much less effort on your car than just going straight up the mountain. Yes, there is longer distance, but it's much less force on your cart. So talking about the screw, it talks about an axle. There's an axle with a inclined plane wrapped around it. All right. So here I have a pencil, right, and we're going to pretend that this is the axle of a screw. And then I have my inclined plane. All right. This edge is going to represent my inclined plane. And I'm going to tape it against my pencil. So I have my inclined plane and I have the axle. Now watch what happens when I twist. When I twist the inclined plane around that axle, okay? What does that look like? You might think, well, it looks like a candy cane. You'd be right, but it also gives you an idea of how the threads form around that axle. Okay, so remember, inclined plane wrapped around an axle that creates the threads on the screw. Something else that you can remember about a screw. Now, in order, when you turn the screw with a screwdriver, one complete turn, the space between the threads, okay, so from here to here is equal distance from here to here. All of those spaces are the same distance. And with one complete turn, that screw goes into the wood or whatever you're screwing it into, it goes in that distance, okay, with one complete turn. So that's something you may not have known about a screw. And let's talk about the last simple machine on page 89. A wedge is made up of one or more inclined planes used to force materials apart. The inclined planes in a wedge form a pointed end. Many common tools use a wedge. An axe used to cut wood is a wedge. The pointed edge splits the wood much more easily than a blunt object would. The blade of a kitchen knife is also a wedge. Okay, so the third one is called a wedge. Now, normally when we think of a wedge, we're thinking of an axe. And what does an axe do? Well, you use it to chop wood or to break it apart into smaller pieces. And that's one function of a wedge, but it can be used in two other ways. The second way you can use a wedge is by connecting two things together. For instance, if I want to hang a picture on the wall, what would I use to put in the wall and then hang the picture? Okay, well, maybe a nail or a screw. It's used, maybe we can screw the picture into the wall. All right. Or when we're screwing nailing maybe two pieces of wood together, it's used to hold two things together. All right. So a wedge can break something apart or hold something together. The third way it can be used is to stop something from moving. For instance, maybe your door doesn't stay open and maybe you want to have a breeze come through your house. But your door just won't stay open. So sometimes if we stick something underneath the door, it keeps it from moving, it keeps it open. That is a wedge. So there's three ways we can use a wedge. First one, of course, to break something apart like an axe. Second is to hold two things together. For instance, if we want to nail two pieces of wood together or screw or nail something into the wall, it holds it together. Also, a tack on a corkboard is also considered a wedge. It's holding a piece of paper to the corkboard. And then the third way is to stop something from moving. All right, let's read the last paragraph together. God created us with the ability to work. He created some simple machines in living things. He wants people to discover others on their own. We mimic God's creativeness and glorify Him when we invent machines that help others. When Christians use machine for work, they are obeying God's command to wisely use the earth and its resources. Okay, so when we're creating, when we're using our time to help others, we're glorifying God. And God gave us minds to be creative, to build different things, to use these ideas of simple machines, not just to help us to make work easier, but also to help others. So think of different ways with these simple machines, how you can glorify God and help others. Now, I'm going to stop the video and I'm going to move, or I'm going to get set up for our activity that is on page 90 and 91. Okay, we're about to start our activity. We're on page 90 and 91 of our student book, and also we're going to be using activity manual page 73. And here we're going to connect this activity to the idea of an inclined plane. Now remember, what was that phrase that we want to remember with all these simple machines? Greater the distance, less effort or less force that we need to move the load. All right, so let's go ahead and read very quickly at the top, and then we'll discuss the process of this activity. Now I apologize if there's noise in the background. It's recess time for my students, but we'll try to stay focused here. Okay, page 90. Is it easier to run up a hill or across a flat parking lot? You likely become more out of breath when you run up a hill. Moving up a hill uses more force than moving across a flat parking lot. In this activity, you will compare two inclined planes or hills. Find out whether the slope of a hill affects the amount of force needed to move a toy car. All right, so remember the inclined plane? Plane is a flat surface. Incline means it's raised on one end. All right, so what we're doing in here, and we can look on page, activity manual page 73, and let's read the problem together. What are we trying to find out in this activity? So we always start with a problem, and that problem is usually a question. Does the amount of force or effort needed to move a toy car increase or decrease as the slope increases or the incline increases? Let's read that again. Does the amount of force or effort needed to move a toy car increase or decrease as the slope increases or the incline increases? Right, that's our problem, and we're going to try to answer that problem in our activity. All right, so the materials we're going to use, and I have this all set up for you, and but I will show you anyway. So we need a plastic cup. Now, we can use something smaller than this, but this is what I have. All right, a plastic cup and a hole punch, and that hole punch is needed to make a hole on the end. And if you want to try this at home, you can follow. And then you need a string about a meter long, okay? A string, and I apologize, this is white in color, right? But that's a string that is about a meter long. 50 pennies, which I have here from our other activities. A toy car, which here, on my toy car. And it says about 8 books. Now, my books here I collected, they're really thin, so I collected about 16 of them. So we're going to say that 2 books equals 1 book in our activity. And then we have a stiff piece of cardboard, which is about 50 centimeters. All right, so we have all of the parts needed to do our activity. Now we go to the next part. This is called our hypothesis. All right, hypothesis. And what is our hypothesis? It's basically a guess, meaning what you think your answer will be to the question. All right, we always start with a question or a problem, and your hypothesis is what you think the answer will be. So here, most of the hypothesis is written for you. You just need to choose one word, the word increase or decrease. All right, so the amount of force needed or the amount of effort needed will increase or decrease as the slope increases. All right, so think of the idea of a hill, going up a hill. Do we need more force or less force as the hill is higher? Right, so think about that. Choose a word and write it in the blank. All right. So, and then we're going to do our activity together and complete the chart and then complete the conclusion. The conclusion is our thinking after the whole project is over. And what was the results, and analyzing this at the end. All right, so let's get right to it. I'm going to set this aside. And we're going to set up our inclined plane. Now, it's best to use some tape in this, because sometimes the tape moves. Okay. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to back as far as I can so you can see the activity. Okay. All right. So we're going to start with 4 books, but in this case, because they're thin, I have 8 books that I'm going to start with. 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And these books are all about the same width. All right. Put them over here on the edge. And we're going to... My desk is not very big, so I have to be really careful. All right, so we got 2 pieces of tape. It's very important that we kind of tape it in place so the inclined plane doesn't move. All right. So we want to tape it on both sides. It just is easier that it doesn't move. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to make sure that the car, I'm going to move over just a bit, and I'm going to adjust the camera. I'm going to angle it down as soon as I get this set up. We're going to make sure that the front wheels are starting on our inclined plane, and we're going to rest the end of the book, or end of the cup, over the books. Now, this is our effort, our force, to move this little cart. Okay, so give me a moment to adjust the camera. Okay, now it's okay if you don't see my head. I want you to see the cup and the cart, all right? So pay attention. We're gonna put force in the cup. And then remember, this is equal to about 4 books. All right, let's count with me. 1, 2, 3, 4. All right, so it took 4 pennies, not much force, to move that car. All right, so now we're going to adjust it. And you can write down 4 pennies in your activity manual. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to adjust the inclined plane, and we're going to add the rest of these books, which will be equivalent to about 8. And you can add as many books as you want to your inclined plane. Right. If you want to play with different heights, you can do that. All right, so now our slope is higher. Okay, our slope is higher. And we're going to rest just the front of the wheels on the inclined plane. Give it a fair advantage. All right, make sure that both sides are correct. And now let's see how many pennies it takes, or how much effort it takes, to move that car up the mountain. You can take a guess in your head. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now that's what it was with the 4 books. 5, 6, 7, 8. Oh, oh, still stuck. 9, 10, 11. Oh, oh, it stopped. 12. There we go. 12. It took 12 pennies to move that car up that very high slope. Hey, very good. Okay. So that's the end of this activity. And I apologize, let me grab my book. That's the end of this activity. So I want you to finish the conclusion together, or maybe you can finish it together with your parents, and discuss what happened in this activity. And also, I want you to do activity manual, page 68, 69, and 70. There are also three questions in your student book on page 89. Okay, I hope you had fun with this activity. And there is one more lesson in this chapter, but it's not required for the test. So if you wanted to go ahead and get ready for that test, you can go ahead and do that, and because the last lesson is not connected to the test. I hope you had a great time. I will see you next time.